Hello 3D printing friends! Today on the BB3D channel we'll take a look at the QidiTech iMate-S fully enclosed 3D printer. Stick around and we'll get into it right after this. I'm Brian, and you are watching BB3D. Hi, welcome back! Hey, if you're new here and you're wanting to learn about 3D printing, 3D modeling, and other 3D printing related stuff, start now by subscribing and clicking the bell so you don't miss anything. Okay, so today we're going to take a look at the QidiTech iMate-S fully enclosed 3D printer. QidiTech recently reached out to me to see if I wanted to take this for a spin. It looked interesting, so I said yes, and so now here we are. This printer comes 100% fully assembled inside a huge box, and that's great because it means you can get down to the business of 3D printing in just a few minutes. You know how when you get something like a Hewlett-Packard laser printer, you get the thing out of the box, remove all the packing materials and accessories, load the toner and the paper, and it's ready to use? This is pretty much exactly like that. So let's talk specs while I get the thing unpacked. It's physically pretty large, about 58 centimeters wide, 46 centimeters deep, and 67 centimeters tall with the spool holder deployed. For those who don't care for the logical consistency of metric units, that's almost 23 inches wide, 18 inches deep, and 26 inches high. For all that size though, its build volume is only 260 millimeters on the x-axis, 200 millimeters on the y-axis, and 200 millimeters on the z-axis. Inside the plastic case is a metal frame, and inside that, the x and y motion all happens up at the top of the printer, and the bed starts out at the top and moves down a bit at a time as the model is printed. It has a removable magnetic build plate that you can flex to remove your prints. It has a power loss recovery feature, so if you lose power during a print job, it can resume printing where it left off. There is a 3.5-inch touchscreen on the front panel and a USB port instead of the usual SD card or micro SD card slot. The printer includes a USB flash drive to plug into that USB port, and there's documentation and software loaded onto it. It has a Wi-Fi radio on board, so if you're using the QidiTech print slicer that comes on the flash drive, you can print directly from the slicer over Wi-Fi. It also has a lid and side panels to keep the printing chamber warm. You should leave these off when printing materials like PLA so they'll cool properly while they're being printed, and put them on when printing materials like ABS that like to stay warmer while they're being printed so they can cool off more slowly and hopefully avoid warping and delamination. The printer also comes with a small spool of PLA plus filament so you can start printing right away. In addition to all that, it includes a spare spring steel flex plate and build surface. It's one of the very few printers that does not come with flush cutters. Those are useful for snipping filament and sometimes removing supports, but apart from that, it has the tools that usually come with 3D printers these days. Allen keys, a wrench, a screwdriver, a scraper to help remove prints from the flex plate if necessary, a glue stick, spare nozzles, spare screws, spare fuses, and so on. And it comes with a spare extruder assembly. The extruder that's installed in the printer at the factory has a 0.4 millimeter nozzle, and the spare one has a 0.2 millimeter nozzle. These extruders have PTFE lined hot ends, and so the maximum temperature that I would want to print at is about 235 or 240 degrees Celsius. Since the printer is already assembled, the only real setup needed, apart from getting all the packing materials out of it, is to perform the initial bed adjustments and load the filament. The USB flash drive included with the printer has several good videos to show you how to perform these setup tasks. The bed uses three-point leveling. There's one adjustment knob at the back and two at the front. When performing the bed adjustments, I have a few tips. First, heat the bed to about 60 degrees Celsius and wait about 5 minutes for the bed's temperature to stabilize. Then follow the instructions on pages 14 through 16 of the guide or watch the video on the flash drive. Both of these guide you through the leveling feature on the touchscreen to make the adjustments. Both the guide and the video make use of this included leveling sheet to set the correct distance between the nozzle and the bed at the adjustment points. It says right on it, special paper for build plate leveling, but it's plastic. Not paper. But anyway, when you're using it, adjust the distance between the bed and the nozzle at all the adjustment points so that you just barely, and I really mean barely, feel a bit of friction. The print surface on this build plate has an absolutely iron grip on PLA, And if you have the nozzle too close, the print surface is not going to want to let go of your finished print. It's best to start with the nozzle maybe a little further away from the bed and bring it closer after a test print or two if you're having trouble getting the filament to stick. As for software, the flash drive includes the Qidi Print Slicer, which is based on the Ultimaker Cura Slicer. It's been simplified so that only the most essential settings are visible, and for me, these settings definitely result in successful prints. They may not be the most beautiful prints, and we'll take a look at some of them later, but they do print successfully. Additionally, more advanced settings are available so you can make adjustments and get things dialed in just the way you like them. The Qidi Print Slicer is available in both Mac and Windows flavors, and I'm grateful that QidiTech made a Mac version of it. Not all printer manufacturers do when they customize Cura. The first time you launch Qidi Print, you'll be asked to select which QidiTech printer you're using. So in this case, you'd select the iMate-S. Since I already have the regular version of Cura installed, the Qidi Print version gets upset about the existing profiles. If you see this "just close the error" message, do not click the reset button. Doing so will destroy all your existing Cura profiles. Now, to be clear, this is a Cura thing, not a QidiTech thing. I've had regular Cura do this to me as well. I once got that message when I opened a newer version of Cura and thought, well, it's telling me that the recommended course of action is to reset these profiles, so I'll do that and then I can adjust them again later. But what it's really saying is that resetting means return Cura to factory settings with no printer profiles at all. So, close the message. Don't click reset. You have been warned. So, now that you've hopefully avoided disaster, using Qidi Print is just like using Cura. Drag in an STL file, select your printing material, and set your layer height, and then slice it by clicking the Prepare button. Then you can save the resulting G-code file to the flash drive. Oh, an optional but very convenient thing to do is to put this printer on your Wi-Fi network so you can print directly from the slicer. There's a short video on the flash drive which shows you how to do this. I did it, and it was actually super easy. So, with the printer connected to my Wi-Fi network, I can click the Wi-Fi icon here in Qidi Print and then send this file to the printer. And once it's been sent, Qidi Print asks if I want to start printing it. Responding in the affirmative will start the print job. One thing to note is that Wi-Fi printing requires that the flash drive be inserted into the printer beforehand. This is so the printer has somewhere to store the file when it receives it so that it can print it. So, having used the printer for a bit, here are some things that I've noticed. First, the printed manual is actually pretty good. It covers the basics of getting the printer out of the box, getting it up and running, performing bed adjustments, and using the touchscreen interface. It's a very visual guide with lots of color photos to show you what to do. It also covers loading and unloading filament from the touchscreen, and it even shows you how to print the included test file. The manual is also available as a PDF document on the USB flash drive, and there are also some good videos on there to walk you through some of the common procedures with the printer, including swapping out the 0.4mm extruder for a 0.2mm one. The whole process of doing that swap looks like it was filmed in real time, and it seems to take less than 5 minutes to do. As for the printer itself, I really, really like this LED strip at the front of this thing that lights up the printing chamber. That's pretty slick, and it makes it easy to see what's going on when printing. I'm also really impressed with the convenience of Wi-Fi printing. Workflow-wise, it's about the exact same process and number of steps that I use when printing to Octoprint from Prusa Slicer. Slice the model, send it to the printer, start the print, done. I also like that the included Qidi Print Slicer has both Mac and Windows versions. I noticed that the files sliced with it also include a preview image of the model, and the iMate-S will show this on its screen. It's a nice way to confirm that the file that you're about to print is actually the file that you intended to print. That 3.5-inch touchscreen is pretty easy to use both for making changes to printer settings and selecting files to print, and it shows you the usual status items while a file is printing. A bar graph shows overall progress. Elapsed time and remaining time are shown, bed and nozzle temperature are shown, and interestingly, the current movement speed is shown. You can adjust printing speed, nozzle temperature, and bed temperature during a print too. You can stop a print job, but you can also pause one and save your place in the file so you can finish printing it later, just like power loss recovery would do. And because the filament does stick so well to the print surface, this is actually a viable option if you need to keep an eye on a print, but you need to go away from the printer for a while. The spool holder seems like it could be a little clunky to change filament, and yes, it can be, because the clamp things that keep the spool centered have set screws on them that require an Allen key to loosen and tighten them. But it's wide enough to accommodate two regular spools of filament, so you can have a spare spool ready to go. Unfortunately, the iMate S doesn't have a filament runout sensor, so it won't tell you when you need to run out and buy more. You'll need to be standing by to manually intervene if you're about out of filament. I did take the opportunity to remove the bottom cover of the printer, and I noticed there weren't ferrules crimped on the mainboard's power input leads or the bed power leads. I inspected the ends of the leads and saw that they were tinned with solder, so I clipped off the tinned ends, stripped off some of the insulation, and crimped on some ferrules. As a quick note, this is something that I'll be looking at on future printers as well. Tinned wire ends, when used with these screw-down terminals, can loosen over time, and loose connections can heat up and pose a potential fire hazard. Bare stranded copper wires are okay, but you have to be careful that all of the strands go into the terminal block. Strands that are sticking out can cause short circuits. From the standpoint of being able to disconnect and reconnect the power leads, such as when servicing the printer, I think using ferrules is the way to go. And now, back to the printer. Although the printer uses silent stepper drivers for the X, Y, and Z axes, the fans on this thing can be pretty loud, and so the overall noise level is pretty substantial. The noise can be reduced somewhat by snapping on the magnetically attached side panels and the top, but of course this isn't an option when you're printing PLA because it'll get too hot in there. One nice thing though is that the hot end fan is thermally controlled, so unlike a lot of my other printers, that fan is only on when the printer's hot end is above 50 degrees Celsius. So when the printer's on and cool, it's absolutely quiet. It's on and cool. And absolutely quiet. Most of the prints that I've done with this printer have been in PLA, but I did a few prints in ABS, which meant that I could have the side panels and the top installed. It seems to me that this printer's main strength is its enclosure and its ability to print ABS. It's like the design focus was to produce a printer that would excel at printing ABS, and then, oh, by the way, you can remove some panels and also print PLA. Now, the heated build platform on this printer is a gloriously thick slab of aluminum. It's like 6 millimeters thick, twice as thick as the aluminum build platform on pretty much every other printer that I have. Now, I think the idea behind this is to make sure that the platform is flat and doesn't have a subtle bowl or dome shape to it. But this also means that the platform is heavy. And because there's only one Z-axis motor and lead screw here, the weight of the platform is enough to spin the motor when the motor isn't on, and so of course the bed glides on down to the bottom of the printer. Now at first, I thought that was going to mean that the printer's power loss recovery feature was going to be completely useless. I mean, how can it resume printing if the bed drops down to the bottom of the printer when the power goes out? Well, it turns out that QidiTech anticipated that, and so the Z-axis end stop is actually down at the bottom of the printer. So when you home Z, it homes down in the basement and then it heads up to the top floor to hang out with the nozzle. Power loss recovery on the iMate S though works differently from every other printer that I've used it on. In order to resume printing, you have to start printing the file that the printer was working on when power was lost. Then you confirm that you want to resume printing the file. And the iMate S makes this a little easier, however, by showing the most recently printed file name in red. On other printers, when power is restored, they ask right away if you want to resume printing the file that they were working on when power was lost. But regardless, I tested this with a Calicat by turning off power while it was printing. The bed sank, and once it stopped moving, I turned the printer on again, selected the Calicat, confirmed that I wanted to resume, and it worked. There was a string of filament that had oozed out of the nozzle when it heated up again, and that of course got stuck on the outside of the Calicat, but that can easily be clipped off, and if that's the worst that happens, it's certainly better than having to trash a print because the lights went out. Also, yes, I know in some instances you can remove the partial model from the bed, figure out where the print stopped, push the model that far down through the bed in the slicer, re-slice it, and print the rest of the model. And then you can glue the two parts together, and in fact I've done something like that before to fix a situation where I ran out of filament near the end of a long print. But if the thing that you're printing is intended as a display piece, that may not be desirable. So speaking of things that I've printed, here are some of the things that I've printed on the iMate S. I have the test print file that came on the flash drive, some calibration cubes, a few calicats, some benchies, and a pair of Luby 3D's Aria Dragons. All of these things printed in red are printed with the included PLA Plus filament, and the things printed in white are printed in a 2-year-old spool of Ziltec ABS. So let's take a look at the PLA prints first, and then I'll get into the ABS prints. This box and cylinder model is the one that comes on the flash drive, and it comes out pretty good. The layers seem very consistently stacked, but you can see some ringing on the print. Here are a couple of XYZ calibration cubes. These came out good too, but again, there's ringing where you can see these ghosted ripples of the shapes of the X and Y on the surface of the print. One of these I printed at the default speed of 60 millimeters per second, and the other I slowed down to 45 millimeters per second. On the slower one, the ringing is somewhat reduced, but it's not a significant reduction, so if you're using Qidi print, you may as well just go with the faster setting. That ringing is something that's fairly consistent on the iMate S, and to that point, one thing that you can sometimes do to reduce ringing is tighten the belts that move the X and Y axes. Unfortunately, there's not a way to do that on the iMate S, and in fact, the only thing providing tension seems to be these spring things that are installed on the belts. Now, moving on to the Calicat models, I have this one that I printed using Qidi Print's default settings, and this one that I printed using my Surmoon D1 settings in Prusa Slicer. There's not a lot of difference between the two, and so based on that, I think the Qidi Print Slicer is doing a pretty good job of simplifying the slicing process and giving good results. This third Calicat is the same Qidi print file, but it's the one that I used to test the power loss recovery feature. And apart from that little splinter of filament that's stuck in its tail, I can't tell that anything happened to it when it was printing. And that's exactly what I'm looking for in a power loss recovery feature, being able to seamlessly resume a print after a power failure. Here are two benchies. Again, one sliced with Qidi print and one sliced with Prusa Slicer. The Qidi print one has this weird under-extrusion looking thing going on at the back on this one side. When I first saw it, I thought maybe there was something wrong, so I stopped the print and then I started it again. And it did the same thing, so I let it finish to see if there were any other problems. But apart from that one bit of weirdness though, that was the only issue. The benchy I sliced with Prusa Slicer didn't have that issue, and in fact it came out pretty good. Now, the last two PLA Plus models are also Qidi Print versus Prusa Slicer prints, a pair of Luby 3D's Aria Dragons. And on this one, I'm giving the print quality win to Prusa Slicer. To me, the Prusa Slicer one just looks better overall. Now, part of that may be that the Prusa Slicer one took a little over 3 hours to print, and the Qidi Print one finished in just under 2 hours. So there was a definite time savings, over an hour, on the Qidi print model, and so Qidi print gets the win for faster print time. Both of them have little wispy bits of stringing between the wings, but that's something that you can tune out with temperature and retraction adjustments, probably. So, on to the ABS prints. I'm going to tell you right now that despite the t-shirt, I am not skilled in printing with ABS. Now, QidiTech tries to make it easier by having printing profiles already set up in their slicer for PLA, ABS, PETG, and TPU, but you may still need to adjust the temperatures and other settings to get a good print. So these first couple of white cubes are evidence of me trying to get the temperatures and cooling settings dialed in on ABS. They started out pretty bad, but after a couple of prints, I was getting acceptable results. This partial benchy is one that was having some serious issues with corner curling during the print, and that's when I turned to the XYZ cubes to start making adjustments. And once I had the cubes coming out good, the benchy came out good too. And just for fun, I printed a Calicat in ABS as well. There was a little bit of corner curling on the 45 degree angle of the tail, but it was minimal, and sometimes I get that on PLA prints as well, so not really a big deal there. And then of course I wanted to really put the enclosure to the test by printing something big in ABS. Since my wife asked me for a divider bin for my coffee pods that are stored in a decorative basket, I took a couple of measurements and put this together in Tinkercad. It's just a 220mm by 110mm by 100mm bin with walls about 2mm thick. This was an 18-hour print. I had the bed at 100 degrees Celsius and I used a temperature and humidity probe that I built a while back to monitor the conditions inside the chamber. Now, the temperature got up to over 50 degrees Celsius and stayed there the entire time, and this print came out great. It didn't lift or curl up off the bed, and the layers stayed consistent the whole way through, no warping or delamination. I printed it at 45 millimeters per second and 235 degrees Celsius with the parts cooling fan turned off. When trying to print faster with this particular ABS, I started hearing the extruder clicking, so faster would mean hotter. But 235 to 240 degrees is about as hot as I'm comfortable printing at with a PTFE-lined hot end, and since that's what the iMate S has on board, that's where I'm setting my temperature limit. So again, I'm not an ABS pro. Apart from one other large thing that I tried printing an ABS 2 years ago on a printer without an enclosure, which by the way had a bit of a warping issue, this bin and the few other things that I've shown you here today are the extent of my ABS printing experience. But I've seen pictures and videos of bad ABS prints, and based on what I've gotten from the iMate S, I think the iMate S delivers good ABS prints. So, summing things up, the iMate S seems to have been designed to give good results with ABS, and by removing magnetically attached side panels in the lid, it does a good job with PLA as well. It includes a spare extruder assembly with a 0.2 millimeter nozzle, and swapping the two is done with the components cold, so there's not a risk of getting burned by accidentally touching a hot nozzle. It comes with a slicer and ready-made profiles for getting successful prints from PLA, PETG, TPU, and ABS, but you also have room to adjust settings if you need to. Using the default settings, the print quality is decent. It's got a bit of ringing in the prints, but without the ability to adjust the belt tension, I don't know if there's a lot that can be done about that. The touchscreen interface is good, but sometimes the on-screen touch targets seem a little bit small, and so you may need to resort to using a fingernail for better accuracy. And I think it would be safer if the power and the bed wires had ferrules crimped on them instead of tinned wire ends. It has quiet stepper motor drivers, but the fans on the printer have taken up the slack, and so the overall noise level is kind of high. But if you're looking for a fully assembled, fully enclosed printer that you can take out of the box, level the bed, load some filament, and start printing, and it also does a good job with ABS prints, the iMate S may be a good choice. It retails for just under $500. Well, 3D printing friends, that's about all the time we have for this episode. And now that we're at the end, let's go print something cool. Hey, real quick before you go, I wanted to say thanks for being one of the super awesome people who sticks around all the way to the end. Thanks for all the likes, comments, and shares. And an especially big thanks to those who directly support what I do. You're all wonderful for doing that, and I really appreciate it. If you liked this episode, a thumbs up would be great. And if you'd like to help support the channel, check the description for ways you can do exactly that. And hey, if you haven't already subscribed, please do. It's absolutely free, and it's an excellent way to help keep me making these videos for you. Well, that's it for this one. Thanks again, and I'll see you next time here on the BV3D channel.